So I'm honored to be here. I'm kind of embarrassed, though, that my qualifications for speaking about failure is because I've left my own craters. In fact, two of the eight startups that I did left craters so deep they have their own iridium layer, and they'll be digging them up 65 million years from now as well. I spent 20 years as an entrepreneur in Silicon Valley, eight startups, retired 10 years ago, and been teaching about entrepreneurship and startups since then. I also have a blog called steveblank.com. The only reason I point that out is these are personal stories of failure. So there's a set of categories on the left. If you want to read some war stories of how mostly to get it wrong and how it really looks like in a startup that doesn't have the Hollywood rewrite that you would read in a case study in Harvard Business Review or a Harvard case, which I love to teach, but they're all kind of whitewashed. And how many of you are in business school? Are you all in business school? Some of you. For those of you who haven't seen it, anybody seen a business school case who's not been in business school? All right. Now, these are little case stories. They're kind of vignettes where you're supposed to learn something from. And they all start with, the founder was sitting in his office, peering out of the window, thinking about it. I mean, there must be, and some of you have read these, are kind of like going, oh yeah, that's a, trust me, it doesn't work like that. It's kind of like six people run into your office at the same time and tell you 16 things have broken and the building's on fire. What do you do? That's usually what a startup is like, and these are kind of stories about that. To me, why startups fail is because of this. Startups fail because they confuse search with execute. And I'm going to explain for the next couple minutes what that means. And by the way, ironically, corollary to this is startups fail directly proportional to the founder's passion, which is kind of like bizarre. Wait a minute. They fail directly proportional to startups' passion. Founder's passion. What does this mean? Well, what's a startup? If you think about a startup, this is box on the left. A startup is an organization designed to search for unknown customers and unknown features. Your goal in a startup is to get from this box on the left to this box on the right. On day one, you know nothing. Ultimately, you want to be Apple, or IBM, or Walmart, or pick whatever country you're going to. You want to be a large success. Companies execute. You may know what the difference between search and execute is. What's execute? What do you do when you're executing?
Doing and implementing.
Yeah, what are you implementing?
Whatever it is that you want to do as a business.
Great, give me some examples.
You're a computer company, you're selling computers.
Great, have you been in sales? Have you been in a company?
Working?
Yeah.
Maybe like educational system?
Great, what did you do?
Secretary of work.
What did you do every day?
Everybody else's work. No, filing, took kids to recess.
Great. You knew how to do that?
No, actually, no.
I know you were searching, but all right, you were supposed to know how to do that. Anybody else work in a company?
Mm-hmm. I worked with a company, mm-hmm. not for a company. And I was just doing training, basic accounting and marketing trainings.
Okay. Did you know what to do?
Nope. No, I knew how to do the basic accounting and right. Try to teach that, yeah.
Anybody else work in a company?
Right. I used to work for Enterprise Rent-A-Car.
Okay. Do they know what to do?
Yes, in fact, they were very clear about what everyone was supposed to do.
Great. So in an existing company, they have processes, don't they? Mm-hmm. Right? By the way, why did Enterprise have processes?
Because they were so large, they wanted everything to be done in a uniform manner, whether you were in North Dakota or Reno.
Bingo, big idea, huge idea. Large companies have processes, so it's repeatable, right? Same type of quality from any place to any place. Big idea. Implicit in that is what kind of people could they hire?
Followers.
Say it again.
Followers.
Big idea, right? And followers, right? So that also meant if you were a follower, what didn't you have to be?
Free.
You bet. You could be, but it wasn't a requirement now for a job that was a process-oriented execution job. And there's no shame to this, there's no pejorative associated to this. It's just that when companies get to scale, right, the only way you could hire 100,000 people is like instead of saying, okay, you guys go Walmart, nude store, why don't you guys, you figure it out how to shelve the stuff. Well, can you imagine customers walking into a Walmart going, wait a minute, it's like this is a reverse Polish notation filing system. Instead, you go to a Walmart and you know exactly where stuff should be, or McDonald's, instead of hiring cooks and saying, you know, why don't you figure out what you're cooking and how you're going to cook it and whatever, at least we know, for better or worse, that we could drive anywhere in the United States and get something that kind of resembles a standard product. That's, in fact, the nature of corporations. And you hire people and you put in processes in place to execute. But the big idea is on day one, early in the midst of those companies' time, they were a startup. They didn't know who their business was. They had no processes. And they didn't understand who their customers were and what they needed to do to serve them. And so a scalable startup is searching for a business model. That is, it's trying to figure out what the right fit is between product and customer. And it's looking for a repeatable sales model. And finally, when it finds it, you're able to hire managers. Steve's definition of what a startup is a temporary organization. Temporary, big idea. Used to search for a scalable and repeatable business model. Oh, now I understand. I thought a startup was the thing you had beer on every Friday and people had fun and, you know, made the newspapers and you made a lot of money. All that might be true. But the organization, the thing you put together, and the type of people you hire are designed to search. Well, that's kind of interesting. If you're searching, what's implicit in the word search? What does search mean? Just what's a,
don't know necessarily what you're looking for.
Oh, big guy. You've got a smart clock. Usually it takes me 20 minutes. We might be done in about... you don't know if... right? It's kind of like anybody like, you know, this is like a scavenger hunt, right? In fact, I don't know why we don't describe startups as like the ultimate scavenger hunt. We really don't know what we're, we kind of have clues. And by the way, what does it take to start a company? What kind of people do you require?
Entrepreneurial?
Yeah, what does that mean? Good, that's a good phrase. Yeah, yeah, no, you got the buzzword. What's it mean? Anybody an entrepreneur? Yeah, what are you?
Creative.
Creative, what else?
Not risk averse, so
okay.
Willing to accept a reasonable amount of risk.
Risk? What else?
Comfort zone.
What else?
I had an idea.
All right. Do you care about it?
Cared enough to put enough time into, well, fail.
Yeah, but you care.
I care, sure.
How much?
Not quite enough, obviously.
Well, I don't, we'll see later. Don't correlate failure with passion. But passion is another characteristic of an entrepreneur. I just want to point out, people who work here show up for a job, right? If you're doing this, it's a religion. By the way I describe this is a faith-based exercise. Now, what screws up startups, this is an aside, is that if it remains a faith-based exercise and you don't replace all the faith with facts, you go out of business. But on day one, there is no possible way, by the way, just as an aside, that you could collect all the possible facts to reduce risk to a certainty in a startup. That's why I call a startup a faith-based activity. You have to have passion and vision and a belief. Again, what screws up startups is people confuse that faith and passion on day one with, well, that's what we'll do to get here. Actually, what we need to do is substitute facts very quickly, and I'll show you how. But a startup really is a faith-based start that requires the search for a repeatable and scalable business model. Does this make sense? It's maybe a different way than you've ever thought about a startup before. It's not just a group of people who, like, you know, show up and then one day, boom, we become a company. It's an organization designed to do something very important. Now, how many startups just go through this magic arrow and become a large company? What do you think their percentage is? Silicon Valley. In Silicon Valley.
Maybe 3-5.
3-5? Out of what? That sounds like the halftime score is 9. I'm sorry, 3-5%. Anybody else? Any other numbers?
1 out of 10.
Yeah, 1 out of 10. In the back?
1 out of 1,000.
Yeah. So it depends what your metric is, right? If your metric is we stay in business for another day, you know, maybe, and it depends on the industry and the, and how bubbly it is, that is how frothy it is, whether it's a economic meltdown or lots of money around, you know, maybe 1 out of 50 stay in business. But it's probably 1 out of 1,000 or 10,000 that founders make substantive money. And by substantive, I mean they're retired now teaching in Monterey. The problem, by the way, and why it's a faith-based enterprise, is who do you think the press writes about? All the stories about startups. Who do you think they're writing about?
The
winners. Who wants to read about losers? It's also a big idea. You guys are not reading the stories about the losers. And so entrepreneurship sounds like, hey, everybody who goes to Las Vegas makes money. Doesn't work that way. It just, as an aside, if any of you are interested in true stories of entrepreneurship, there's a woman named Jessica Livingston who wrote a book called Founders at Work. And it's not a novel, it's 35 vignettes. And I call it, again, this is the classic Harvard case studies without the Hollywood rewrite. Some of you might have heard the book. Most of you might know her about her current job. Does anybody know about a company called Y Combinator? She's the co-founder. Her instinct as an interviewer comes through here, and you could understand why she succeeded at Y Combinator. Startups fail because they execute when they should be searching. This is back to the passion of a founder. If you believe on day one you have the vision, I know exactly what we should be, and somebody's smiling, I know exactly what we should be doing, because this is the product, this is the customer, let's go build it, and when we ship it, people will stand there and just like line up and buy it. Don't laugh. That's tied to the passion and the vision of a founder, because how else would you ever leave your job, tell your spouse or whatever that, like, we're eating crackers and saltines for the next, you know, couple months, and, like, you know, mortgage, you know, everything you have. You gotta believe. The problem is that passion and belief blind you to the distinction between execution and searching. The reality is, on day one, most, though not all, most startups don't know enough to go into execution. Even though you are so passionate, you want to build it, you want to sell it, you want to get out there, when what you should really be doing is searching. And so the interesting question is, you know, what is searching in a startup? And by the way, how does that differ from what you do in a large company? So, a startup, the box on the left, large company, box on the right, little box in the middle, by the way. Anybody ever been in a startup? Anybody? So there's a little box in the middle. Can I tell the box in the middle story? The box in the middle story is the memo you never get from venture capitalists, and that's called the transition. World-class entrepreneurs are spectacular in search. Can we just say that as a given? They're great at searching. Those same entrepreneurs typically hate managing 10,000 person companies. Even though you would think, hey, that's my reward, I get to be CEO, etc. If you're spectacular at doing 7,000 different things simultaneously, the odds of you loving to push paperwork is probably about zero. Some entrepreneurs make that transition, most don't. What happens though is your investors, when you have found a repeatable and scalable business model, start looking at you funny. They come into your board meeting and for the first time, they actually notice you. And you notice them noticing you, and it makes you feel pretty weird because, in fact, you just found a profitable business model. You thought they were going to pin a medal on you and give you the parade. But instead, they're looking at you, and all of a sudden, there's only good news in this board meeting. I mean, you're talking about how much money you're making. It's great. We think we're going to go skim. And your board members, why are they doing that? Why are they doing that?
Seeing if you're fit to keep running the company.
You bet. But wait a minute. Isn't it your due? Isn't it owed you? Right? You just nailed it. You did great as the founder. What do you mean they're seeing if you're fit? Why would they care? Why would an investor care whether you're fit? Well, what about it?
They were protecting.
Well, why? They were doing fine protecting it when we were over here, but now we're over here. Why would they care more?
Maybe endurance in the long run.
I'm sorry?
Endurance to see how they, if they're, you know, persistent and resilient into the long run, maybe 2 or 3 years down the line.
Possible?
They know it takes a different kind of person, different skill set to...
Great. So what? They tell me that. Big deal. So what? Keep you on a roll. Why do they care?
They care because they want the company to be successful.
Why do they care?
Their dividends.
I'm sorry?
Their dividends.
Dividends? How do VCs make money? Dividends? Public offerings, mergers and acquisitions, more likely today, etc. Wait a minute. You were great. You found the business model, and now they realize it's potentially... Anybody know, by the way, how many board meetings these investors are going to? Do you know how many boards they're on? Typical venture capitalists in Silicon Valley? 10 to 12.
Wow.
Right? 10 to 12. So by the way, the first couple months, you're thinking, you know, they're just showing up at your board meeting. What you don't realize is when they pull into the parking lot outside, they got to look up the name of the building. You know? And they're going, oh, yeah, yeah. And then they got to get out the Rolodex and figure out who your name is. And they're absolutely great actors because you think they've been thinking about you all week. They barely know your name. Except all of a sudden, now when you tell them you're about to make a pile of money, they're thinking, holy cow, this could be the one out of 20 companies that I've invested in this portfolio that might return the entire portfolio. And now all of a sudden, your job, this is really ironic, your job is more at risk than it was over here. Right? Unless you were really screwing up, there's no need for a VC to get rid of you when you were searching, as long as you were doing a good searching job. Boy, this is a very funny time for a successful entrepreneur because your expectations versus the unknown and unsent memo that the VCs never sent really conflict. And that's why you hear all these stories from founders who say, oh, I was doing great, and those darn VCs removed me just when we were doing wonderful. And it's because the interest, or there's a phrase I use, called, are your interests aligned or unaligned? Your interests are aligned here. Right? VCs are happy to have you working 24/7, you know, 390 days a year. They'll add another month just for you. But when it comes over here, your interest and theirs might become unaligned. Make sense? That was just the secret box that they don't tell you. So a startup, though, is designed to search for a business model. Search. That's what your job is. You think it's engineering, you think it's marketing and sales? No. The meta job is to search. Is there a profitable business? But a large company, as we said earlier, is to execute a business. We already found the business model. I need processes. I need people who know how to do that. I need execution. In a large company, anybody take accounting? Balance sheets, income statements, cash flow? You can't run a large company, or any company, without knowing all this stuff. Who has the money, where it is, you know, how are we spending, what kind of expenses, what's each department, division, or subsidiary doing. This makes all kinds of sense in a large company. Yet, when I was in a startup, my venture capitalist would ask me to prepare this same accounting stuff for my startup, which had no income. And a supercomputer company had no income for 2.5 years. So I would have my CFO prepare a stack of paperwork this deep. Income statement. What do you think it said on month one in my startup?
Zero.
Month two?
Zero.
Month three?
Zero.
Four. Now, only after 20 years does this seem incredibly stupid. Because there are VCs today who are still insisting that startups prepare the stack of papers. Why? Because VCs, that's what they know. What's the only number that matters in a startup until you have revenue?
One.
I'm sorry?
One.
No, there are other numbers, but what's the... No. No. What's the only number that matters? What keeps you in business or not?
Investment.
Cash. Cash. What's your cash flow? What's your cash flow? How many days do you have till you hit the ground? Right? Expenses are part of that, right? But, you know, am I getting a revenue I could control? And the sum of that sometimes is called burn rate, right? If you've ever heard that phrase, how much, it's just a shorthand for how much cash am I burning per month? And then you look at the piggy bank and go, how much is left in the piggy bank? That's all you need to know until you start generating revenue. What you really want to be working on in a startup are metrics that are very different than accounting. Metrics are, how am I doing in searching for my business model? And here's some metrics for an internet company. What's my customer acquisition cost? Is this thing viral? Do I know about lifetime value? That is, am I going to get more sales from the same customer? What's my average selling price? And here's the accounting number. What's my monthly burn rate? Large company metrics need to know this in a large company. But you take a CFO or even a venture capitalist, and then they start handing you those things to report in your board meeting. You know, it's kind of like asking somebody, anybody ever see old movies where they always sent the husband out of the room to boil water when the wife was having the baby? Anybody ever see old movies? Go boil some water. I never understood. What does boiling water, anybody know what they were doing?
Distracting him?
Yeah, they were distracting him. Get the hell out of the way, boil some water. Well, what do I do with the water? Boil some more. You know, it's the same thing in asking a startup to go do this. None of it is particularly relevant or helpful in you trying to find a business model. And smart board members nowadays are starting to go, oh yeah, this is what we learned in business school. But to really be engaged and helpful in a board, we really need to help the company understand what their business model is. Sales. Anybody ever see a large company VP of sales? Anybody ever see what do they look like?
Oh, very sharp, clean cut.
Yeah, how tall are they?
6'9".
Yeah. They look 6'9", they're about 6'3". Swear to God. Fortune 100, I think there's a genetic modification program going on in the United States. Because they also, not only, you know, they're typically still male, typically still about 6'2", silver hair. Man, I don't know, I think they were born with clothes on, because they look good. And they have putting greens, and they're you know, they're handicapped in like single digits, because they have another career if they like screwed up as sales. And we laugh, but if you ever go to the Bohemian Club and look at these guys, it's exactly who they are. They're world class in building sales organizations. They know how to scale sales. They know how to build a sales organization that sells off of price lists and data sheets that marches to a revenue plan. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with this. In a large corporation, this is what sales executives do. And if this is the title of VP of sales, they know what their job is, or if your title is regional manager or salesperson, you know exactly what your execution job in sales is. And I'm now going to explain to you why hiring people from large companies never works in a startup. They know how to execute. Their title is sales, VP of sales, regional manager, salesperson. In a startup, when you're searching for a business model, do you know what the price list looks like? Do you know what the product looks like? In fact, I used to make up the product in the parking lot outside of each customer. PowerPoint was great. Sometimes I'd make it up on the whiteboard, going, Well, what do you guys think? Oh, Steve, too bad. If you only had an X, we'd buy it. Whoa, I forgot to show you about the X. Well, it's probably too expensive. Well, what would you think too expensive? Well, we couldn't pay more than $1 million. It's $950,000. Okay, you know, so I swear. I swear. So if you think about, though, hiring execution people into the role in a startup, what really screws us up in startups is using the same titles. We say, oh, we're hiring a VP of sales. Everybody must know that in a startup, the role is very different. No, we don't. And by the way, you think I'm talking about sales? Add the word VP of marketing, VP of biz dev, VP of anything you know that works well in an wait a minute, the salesperson was in the top 1% club. Shouldn't they be doing great in my startup? Only after your startup is in execution mode over here. If you're in this box and you're still searching for a business model, you want people capable of dealing with early adopters when the pricing or features or product are completely unstable and not yet repeatable and truly are done by one-offs. Typically, this has to be done by the founders dragging along a salesperson who is incredibly flexible and is the one out of 100. Does this make sense? It explains a lot about why great execs here, it's not that they're bad. It's just they don't understand. You've just dropped them on a desert island with a loincloth and a knife, and it's survival school. It's not the comfortable life they were living here. Question.
What is
one-off? Well, one-offs mean, remember I just described going to the whiteboard and making a custom product that's called a one-off product, meaning it's just a, you know, just for you. And by the way, the nice thing about founders is you find a customer that says, I'll buy 10,000 of those. You go, I bet you there are other customers. And in fact, what you use is you have customers help you design the product in a startup. Does that make sense? Product management. In large companies, there are people called product managers who deliver market requirements documents. These are the features we need, and this is what we should build, and here's our competitors. Makes all kinds of sense in a large company when you know the customers and the markets, etc. In a startup, all you have are hypotheses. Big idea. In a startup, all you have are hypotheses. You may know what a hypothesis is outside of a classroom. What's the unofficial word for a hypothesis?
Guess.
Guess. Guess. Right? We'll use hypotheses here because you're paying money for this class. Right? But outside in the real world, you're just effing guessing. And a startup is nothing more than a set of connected guesses. We say hypotheses, because we can't say effing guessing in a classroom, but and here's what's really interesting. In a large company, engineering takes this requirements document from the product management team and goes into something called waterfall development. Any engineers in this room? Anybody know what waterfall development is? Seems pretty rational. Thanks for giving me the specification of what the customers want. Okay. I've turned those specifications into a list of features. This is what happens in every traditional company. Okay, here's the list of features. I'm now going to hand them to my engineering team. We'll give you an estimate of when the product could come out, typically a year or two, and then go away because we're now going to be developing the product a step at a time, and we'll let you know when we're done. Thank you. We got the spec. Go away. We're engineering the product. Come back when it's done. Make sense? That's called waterfall development. It makes 100% sense when you know who the customer is, you know the market, and you know the features they want. It's not stupid in a large company with existing customers. Where is it stupid?
Startup.
Because you don't know the customers. And you're guessing about all the features. Uh-oh. So about 10 years ago, someone came up with this idea that says we could do a different type of engineering called agile development. Actually, Toyota invented this in the 60s for automobiles, but we reinvented it again for software. Agile development says we're not going to build the whole product at once. We don't know enough. We're going to do engineering by increments and iteratively. We're going to build, at first, the minimum feature set, or sometimes called the minimum viable product. What do we think the minimum is that we could get somebody excited about? Not every bell or whistle they'll want forever, Can we find anybody who would like be passionate about the product now? And it turns out this plays on an interesting characteristic of startups. You are not selling as a startup to mainstream customers, which means you're not selling to everybody on day one. That's what usually screws up founders. Everybody should love it on day one. No. Only the crazy people should love it on day one. And so what you're looking for are the crazy people who have you found and engineered the key core features for. Does that make sense? All right. So there are 387 million reasons to fail in a startup, and here are the five reasons why. If you were to take all the possible choices of who are my customers, who's my channel, what features should I have, what's my revenue model, what's my expense model, and just multiply it out, and say there you could build a business model with 9 components, there's about 9 combinatorial choices. So if you were just kind of randomly throwing them out there, this is why this is a hard problem. This is why startups are hard. And so the interesting thing is, if there are 387 million choices, and probably more, how do I collapse them into something we could search in our lifetime and have a chance of success? Well, the first is to realize that more startups fail from a lack of customers than from a failure of product. This is a big idea, particularly in technology startups. Holy cow, I thought we were taking more risk on the product side than the technology side. It's not that engineering is never late. In fact, I've never been in a startup where engineering was ever early. But it's not like engineering never delivers the product. It's that we never deliver enough customers to make this a profitable business. So here's the failure modes of a startup. Anybody write a business plan? Anybody ever write a plan? Yeah. Here's why I hate business plans. It's something you ought to do, by the way, one time in your life. You ought to really do it. It helps you understand all the components of a business. And there's a section in the back, which is the spreadsheet, which is the best creative writing exercise you'll ever do. It's better than English. Anybody ever put together a financial plan? You should truly do that one time in your life. Okay? Though I'm still convinced there's a secret Easter egg in Excel that if you hit the right key combinations will auto-generate a $100 million five-year plan automatically. But the problem with the business plan is that it's static. Big idea. A plan is static. It's a research project. But no business plan in the real world, if you've ever been an entrepreneur, survives first contact with customers. Just like war. You have all the great plans. The minute you get out of the building, you throw your business plan away. So the problem is you need a scientific method to search the space, not a static plan. And by the way, professors love business plans. Any idea why? Why in their business plan competition? Any idea why professors love plans? Say it again.
Easy to grade.
Easy to grade. Seriously. And B, I could say it here, but I can't say it at Stanford or Berkeley where I teach. Why else do they love it? You don't, go ahead.
I can use the idea to properly start research.
Gee, I wish they were that smart. No. Why?
It has a structure.
So it has a structure.
You don't have to prepare too much.
You don't have to prepare too much. And also, by the way, in most schools, them have never been in a startup. Right? In a business school, most professors who consult, do you think they consult for startups or General Electric? Large companies. So, but gee, I can understand how to grade or teach an entrepreneurship class. See, it's, did this have enough market research? How many lines was that? Is it valid? Gee, was the team thing well written? And I'm not really dissing and tell you it's completely useless, but spending more than a week on putting your plan together is just a waste of time. Here's what you ought to be doing. You need a scientific method to search the space. So what you want to do is structure the search with a business model. Now, in your career, if you haven't already, you've probably heard the word business model about 400 times. And I have to tell you, if you had 3 professors in a room, you get 19 definitions until now. Now there really is a way to define a business model. And the next section comes from a book that you need to have on your shelf, even more than mine. Mine's a great paperweight, but the next stuff is actually worth looking at. And it's from a book called Business Model Design by a guy named Alexander Osterwalder, and you could download most of the book, in fact, the most relevant part, from his website. Just look for Business Model Canvas. He gives you the first 72 pages for free. But basically, Osterwalder said, listen, let's stop, you know, everybody making up your own definition of business model. I can define for you a company in 9 boxes. And once we define your company in 9 boxes, we're going to use that definition to help you structure your search as a founder and eliminate as much risk as we can. So Osterwalder said the first thing we ought to be thinking about is who's the customer. And by the way, a customer gets kind of complicated. I used to think, oh yeah, the customer is the person who uses the product, right? Yeah, is that what a customer is? Anybody ever sell to a corporation? Anybody ever do any? Who's a customer in a company?
Well, it depended. I mean, the corporation itself, Ernst & Young, was a customer, but we served actually their employees.
Great. Which employees?
A wide range of them, from secretaries all the way up to some of their top executives.
Great. So the secretary used your product?
Yeah.
What was it? What was the product?
Customized English language training.
Great. Good. So the secretary paid for the product?
Yes.
All right.
In conjunction with the company. Actually,
well, wait a minute.
Shared plan with them.
Oh, really? Well, then was there somebody else involved in the approval process?
Sure.
Well, wait a minute. I thought the secretary was a customer.
Yeah.
Well,
very, very convoluted, actually.
Well, who else was a customer?
You know, from their headquarters in the Netherlands all the way to their offices in Moscow.
Whoa.
Down the line.
Whoa. So the definition of a customer might be a little more complicated. Anybody ever have a relative or know anybody who got a hip replacement or an artificial joint? Okay. Who was the customer?
Who got the...
Who was the customer?
The insurance company.
The insurance company. My
grandfather. Really? Did they put the hip in the insurance company?
No.
Who'd they put it in?
Grandfather.
Well, wasn't he the customer?
He's one of them
customers.
Well, who else was the customer?
The insurance company.
Who else?
The doctors.
Well, what did the doctor have to do with it?
They're the one putting it in. They have to be comfortable
with it. Well, weren't they just like, did they specify it? Could they have picked another one?
Well, yes.
Oh, interesting. So life gets kind of interesting here. All I want to point out is when we first think of customer, I always think of the user. But it turns out there in lots of markets, there are users, there are payers, there are recommenders, there are influencers, there are saboteurs, you know, people who go, oh my God, if they install this, I'm out of a job. So, while this might look like a duh box, duh, it's the customer, trust me, in a bunch of industries and markets, customers get very interesting. And, by the way, you might have multiple customer segments in one business. Anybody ever use something called Google? Who's a customer?
Advertisers?
Wait a minute, I thought you used Google.
We're the product.
Whoa. Multiple customers. How much do you pay when you use Google? To do a search?
Three.
Well, how do they stay in business? There's another customer, isn't there? Interesting. So don't take this as a simple box. Value proposition. This is a fancy word. I love this. Business school guys love the word value proposition. What the heck does this mean? What's a value proposition?
What's the unique thing on the business?
Yeah, what are you selling? It's value proposition. I used to think, oh yeah, it's the box I'm making that I'm selling to somebody else. But it could be software, it could be service, it could be a combination of hardware, software, service, etc. This is what you've decided that your vision is, that people are going to line up and make you a trillionaire. Right? This is the value proposition. Channel. What's a channel? It's a hint, there's a truck.
How you get your product to
them. Say it out loud.
How you get the product to the customer.
You've been cheating. Yeah. So what are the ways to get a product to the customer? How do we do that? What are different ways to get stuff to customers?
Well, let's say you sell a car, if you manufacture a car, one of the ways is through dealerships.
Dealerships, yep.
Or trade shows.
Yep. How else do we get product to the customer?
Downloaded,
so the web, yep.
Mail,
yeah. Direct sales, retail channels. You go into still there are physical stores left. I think we ought to take pictures of them because they're probably going to disappear. Channels, by the way, can either be physical or they could be bits, right? Bits are kind of the last decade. Now we think of sales channels that could be virtual, but sales channels could also be physical. And specifically, when you get down to it, a channel is the vehicle. But just as an aside, anybody ever look at the book publishing business? Right. From you, the author, to a reader, you wouldn't believe how many people physically touch your book. Distributors and, you know, like bookstores and retail channels and whatever. And by the way, they're all not doing it for free. One of the interesting things of a channel is you should think of this funnel that gets narrower and narrower in terms of maybe going the other way about how much money you actually get at the end of the cycle. If there was a, you know, $10 book, the author gets like 42 cents. Well, whoa, where'd all the money go? Well, each part of the channel takes them. Customer relationships. How are you creating demand with the customer? Revenue streams. What's a revenue stream? What's a revenue stream? What does it sound like? I'm sorry?
How many different ways to make money?
You know, how many different ways are there to make money?
If you're making one product, it's compartmentalized.
Yes. How many ways?
So you can either sell like the parts of a computer, or you can sell the computer itself, or you can sell the software that goes with it.
Yeah.
Depends on what your business is.
Infinite.
Yeah.
Infinite. I could give it away.
Yeah, you could do that too.
Right? Doesn't Google give away their product? They give away one part of their product to create users so they could charge another group. That's when business models get interesting. Now on the web, people have a notion of something called freemium. I'll give you the base product and I'll charge you for add-ons. There are subscription services. There's the old, it's getting obsolete, but I go into a store and there's a price for the product and I actually know what it is and I get to buy it until it breaks and then like I got to buy it again. There's the iTunes model. That is, there are a whole bunch of models, but at the end of the day, you have to have a convincing business model that's past, oh, we'll get a million users and we'll worry about it later. I mean, maybe you could get away with that. I doubt it. Key resources. What do you need to make your company successful? Key activities. What do you physically need to do to make it successful? Do you need partners? And what are your expenses? You could describe any company in the world with these 9 boxes. Any company. And if we use these definitions, which aren't perfect, but they're pretty darn good, we then now have a common definition of what a business model is. And why I love this is that it allows us to focus as a startup in searching for the answers in each one of these boxes. It now helps us say, wait a minute, so I've now just redrawn that in a formal diagram called the Business Model Canvas. You could download this from the web. I have my startups paste these on the wall on day one. And what they do is tell me what your value proposition is. Don't write it in pen because you're going to be changing it. Use yellow stickies. Who do you think your customers are? You know, just guess because that's all you're doing. And if you've written a business plan, this is extracted from your plan. And we'll save you the time if you don't want to write one because you're going to do it in yellow stickies. The failure that most startups make is assuming that your business model is correct on day one. I've put all those stickies up. Great, Steve, I'm done. You have to realize that even when you put those yellow stickies up, they're just hypotheses. Or as we said, guesses. But Steve, you just convinced me this is a great way to plan and think about my business. I now just thought about, okay, I got it. I got my company now down instead of 387 million possibilities. I wrote them down. The problem is there are no facts inside your building. Just remembering this can reduce failure by about a factor of 20. Startups fall in love with their passion. I've now given you a framework to write down your hypotheses, but understand that once you've written them down, it doesn't make them facts. So what you want to do is formalize testing your hypotheses outside the building. What does outside the building mean? What does it mean? Yeah, what kind of research?
Talk to real people.
Thank you. Talk to real people. Now, if you go to business school, you know, oh, Steve, I get it. It's, you know, industry analysts and it's all the market data and it's what, I don't know if anybody's ever thought of this, but if all the market research people were wonderful geniuses, they'd be rich and retired. Market research firms are spectacularly great at predicting the past. That's why they're market research firms. And they could extrapolate trends. And if they were much better, they'd be Wall Street analysts. I'm not suggesting that the data is not useful. But for me, having valid information in a startup is a hierarchy. Yes, I want all the market research data. I assume you will read it all. In fact, to me, the test is, boom, here's a pen, go up to the whiteboard, and depending on your industry, let's say it's enterprise software, draw me Gartner's magic quadrant of the business. And that's just like a going-in minimum. Three is, yeah, I assume you've been using SurveyMonkey or its latest equivalent to go out and electronically survey people. But until I've looked at a customer's eyeball and watched their pupils dilate, you really have no ground truth. You have no ground truth, and you're confusing theory with practice. Practice is, once you have ground truth, all that data either makes sense or not. So you want to test the business model with this process called customer development. And those workbook pages in the back now map to each one of the boxes in the business model. So here are the hypotheses I want to go outside and test. And you want to test a whole suite of them. In the meantime, your engineering group is building the product incrementally, and you're testing this with a customer development team. And because you used yellow stickies, and because you've put this on the wall, you could actually, once a month, put up a new version of this and go, here's what we thought last month, here's what we thought this month, here's what we're thinking month after month, and you will see your progress as you're getting smarter. So testing the business model is this four-step customer development process. And the first step simply says, listen, I have a set of hypotheses. I want to get outside the building and test them. And the next step is, once I test them, I actually want to see if I could get orders from an unfinished, incomplete, buggy product. Why? Because you would think, well, Steve, the whole mainstream market won't buy an unfinished product. But the interesting thing about commerce is, if you can't find some crazy people whose needs you've met with even the core product, it doesn't get better over time. The answer is not, let's go build some more. The answer, which is really kind of interesting, is it happens all the time. Meaning, your first hypotheses in a startup are usually wrong, not right. And this is where life gets interesting about adopting and embracing failure. This is what screwed up startups for the last 40 years in Silicon Valley, is that we've always assumed that because you wrote it down in a plan and put it in a spreadsheet, somehow customers will behave like your plan. And when they didn't, we would have a crisis in a boardroom, and you know how we'd fix you didn't make the revenue plan crisis? Who'd you fire?
The salesperson.
Of course. Fire the VP of sales. You know what the half-life of a VP of sales is in a Silicon Valley startup?
6 months.
13 months.
Oh, wow.
What they don't realize is they have a bummer of a birthmark, where it's a bullseye on their back. They just can't see it. The way we solve crisis problems today, or at least the last couple of years, is we fired executives. Now, here's the interesting point, which will bring us all the way back to this. What strategy do you think the new sales VP used? Really? Are they stupid?
That's what they've been taught.
No. What customer strategy do you think? I don't mean customer development or whatever. Do you think they called on exactly the same people the same way? Gee, if they had a minimum level of intelligence, they'd go, well, that didn't work. Those were the wrong users, or that was the wrong types of companies. Let's call on someone else. Implicitly, firing execs change course in startups. It's a big idea. I'm just observing that if that's been the case, maybe we should just say that most startups actually get it wrong the first couple of times, and we ought to just build in a natural feedback loop that says instead of firing people, we'll say, hey, this didn't work. Look, we were wrong. Why don't we just pivot, which is just a fancy way for saying, go back to step one and change some of our hypotheses on the business model diagram. A pivot is defined as when you go back to that business model diagram and change one of the boxes. That's a pivot. And it doesn't require firing an executive. So as I said, a mistaken hypothesis creates a crisis. Pivots are business model changes without a crisis. And the pivot turns failure into insight. So going from here to here, where normally in a standard startup done by executing a revenue plan, you would fire executives, here you just simply embrace it. And it allows you to be fast, agile, and opportunistic. And the pivot just changes the business model. You rip off a new page, you put it on the wall, you're saying, here's what we found out. The last piece is thinking that we have plenty of time. That's another failure mode. Hey, we got plenty of time, we'll think about this, we'll get this right next year. Startups are all about urgency. Why are startups about urgency?
Competition.
What? I'm sorry?
Competition.
Somebody competition. Possibly.
You don't have an infinite amount of time to pick everything.
Why?
People want results. People
why?
Have to pay the bills.
Say it again.
Okay. Got to pay the bills.
With what?
Money.
What kind of money?
Not your money.
Cash. Urgency is about you're about to run out of money and hit the ground. Which is why rich people doing startups are a bad idea. No joke. No joke. So, you know, you never want to, my heuristic, you never want to join a startup where one of the founders have already made $1 billion. They're not desperate enough. You will tend to say, well, we have the luxury of thinking about this, etc. You don't have plenty of time. Startups are built for rapid search. Remember I said startups are about search, companies are about execution? If you're the type of individual that requires 100% certainty in decision making, you are not cut out to be a founder. Just, you ought to understand this. It's not about you, it's not about intelligence, not about whether we like you or not. Entrepreneurs and founders who run startups make decisions with insufficient data. They're not guesses, but they're based on pattern recognition. And that's what we mean by rapid search. It's not just the pivot, it's the cycle time, it's the tempo. The speed of the cycle minimizes your cash needs. And the fact that you're building a minimum feature set, not the entire product, speeds up the cycle time. And by the way, today with the internet, most businesses, at least those on the net, can get near instantaneous customer feedback. So, 387 million ways to fail. Here are some of them. No business plan survives first contact with customers. If you want to fail, just assume your business model is correct. But just remember, the reality is there are no facts inside your building, and that it's mistaken hypotheses that create crisis. Basically, the hypotheses kind of show up and, gee, we didn't make the revenue plan. But underlying that were some assumptions about one of those nine or multiples of those nine boxes in the business model. Another failure mode is not having urgency. So that's the presentation. But for this crowd, can I add just 30 seconds more? Does anybody know what they call a failed entrepreneur in Silicon Valley? Experienced. It's a huge idea for where you're going outside of this area. In most parts of the United States, let alone the world, you know what they call the failed entrepreneur? A failure. Okay? And in other places in the world, they not only call you a failure, it's shame on your family, you know, your village, your culture. You have to leave, and you never get another chance. So understand that everything I've been talking about is not in a risk-averse culture, it's been in a culture that celebrates risk. Silicon Valley is an innovation center because of lots of things, but most importantly, because it does not kill failure. It celebrates it. Does this make sense? It is a big idea. So you'll take all of these great lectures and, gee, Steve said X and Y, and then, like, you'll hit a brick wall wherever you're going. First thing, whatever I would do, because I just came back from Chile, which the government has said, we're doing innovation and entrepreneurship, government mandate. And, of course, you find out that, gee, if you are a failed company, there is no bankruptcy courts or even commercial courts. It takes you 7 years to unwind the company. Whoa. And you fail? Man, people point at you in the street. You know, so, like, who wants to do startups in that culture? You really got to be insane. So it doesn't mean there isn't any, but the first thing I would do in any country is put your ear to your ground and a finger in the air and understand what the local culture is about failure. Because startups are about taking risk. Does this make sense at all? Which is why people come to Silicon Valley. You think it's the technology and the weather? Yes, yes. And the money and the venture capital? All yes. This is why there's a book that you should all read if you're going overseas. I'm just adding your reading list. It's called Regional Advantage. And it's by a professor called Annalise Exinian. And she described why Silicon Valley beat Boston for the title of the innovation center in the United States. And by the way, when I came out to Silicon Valley, I think when you were here, it wasn't clear whether Route 128 in Boston was going to dominate or whether Silicon Valley was going to dominate. And she goes through the reasons why Silicon Valley won. And the one that kept hitting home for me was the one as follows. In Boston, when you started a company, you were living within driving distance of your family and extended family. And the culture on the East Coast of the United States is you worked for a company for life. And when you did something abnormal, like you quit Digital Equipment Corporation and you're going to, who are these new people? Do I know their mothers? You know, who are they? You know, like, wait a minute, they come from a good family? Mom, I don't know. You just, all of a sudden, you had this enormous cultural weight to stay to the norm. Even in technology businesses. All of a sudden, in Silicon Valley, you could get on an airplane, tear up your name, your passport, and your history, and reinvent yourself here. And no one back home would ever know what you're doing. And that actually mattered for a lot here. So I just want to, for those of you going overseas, want to tell you this is all great theory, but understand it's culturally determined by a lot of what's going on here. And you know, for those of you who come from these cultures, duh, you know, but for those of you like grown up in the Silicon Valley culture, it is not the norm. It is an aberration even in the United States. So I'm done. Thank you. I'll take questions if you have a minute or anybody? Yeah, sure. Yes.
Have you had extensive experience working abroad with entrepreneurs?
Just a bit. So Stanford has this program with Chile and with Finland. I spent a month with some entrepreneurs. I took my whole family to India for a month. We did some little work in between on vacation in Tanzania, but I wouldn't say extensive. But I've been out in the U.S. and this cultural stuff is a big deal. And half my students obviously are from China, or mostly China and India, in both Stanford and Berkeley. And then we also teach the National University of Singapore, which also has a national program. I mean, you know, when I think I really pissed off the head of the program when I said, help me understand, you're training entrepreneurs and they are not allowed to spit on the street? You know, I don't know if you know, you'd go to jail in Singapore if you did that. I said, why don't we have them have a special badge that said if they're entrepreneurs, they're allowed to spit? Oh, we couldn't do, and I was joking, and he was like, thinking it was a, oh, that would really, you know, mess up our system. The president would have, the premier would have to sign off on that. So, but they still do a pretty good job. So the answer is a little bit. But, why?
So I was wondering, like, in those environments, in those cultures where it's a little bit risky and as tolerated as much as it is here, do you find that the entrepreneurs that either are successful or do fail, that they're the ways that they come up with to get around the intolerance of risk there?
I have found, and again, I'm going to generalize, and this is a much longer discussion, and I would suggest you have it in the next 2 days or be asking yourselves and each other this. Just so this is Steve's probably wrong observation, but the one I observed is they're even crazier than the ones here, but they're also more attuned to the cultural sensitivities on how to do things that you would go, well, why don't we just announce it, or why don't we just tell everybody? No. See the guy over there? That's the most influential person. And unless we get that person starting using this or doing this, it isn't going to happen, right? And so it really is actually, they instinctually know how to build a cultural influence map about who's important, what's important, and they don't do it the way a loudmouthed American marketeer would do it. They're much more sensitive and subtle about influence. That was my observation. Those of you who come from different cultures should probably be the ones smacking all of us here in the head about how, is that?
Yeah, sometimes it also makes it so that you might think of the people being secretive because, again, some failure might be attributed to bad luck or bad influence coming from somebody else. So people are very careful when they engage in a first time scratch up as a you will put it as not a startup, but something they haven't actually experimented yet. So to
me, if I was going overseas, I would treat this as a order of battle problem. Meaning, unless you personally could go to the whiteboard for me and draw me what's the cultural influences of new ideas and whatever, don't be the loudmouth American going out and thinking whatever worked here. In fact, I will guarantee you, this stuff won't work until you understand that. You had a comment?
Yes. Dr. Zelkha was talking about inquisitiveness.
Yes.
When talking about, search.
Yes.
What you actually put search, yeah, as opposed to execute. Now, the FM Frontier Scouters, I would say when you're in an environment that is completely different than yours, the first point of reference would be first to listen and understanding the culture more than to, and ask questions in the way that you, not that you think you would want to have the answer, but in the way the region or the culture...
I couldn't agree more.
...would ask the question in order to have the answer that is interesting.
I think you nailed it. So for those who are reading the Four Steps book, you need to think of a chapter zero about being really attuned to not only getting questions, but being careful on how you ask questions that even the discovery process isn't insulting or turned off. In the U.S. you could ask anybody anything. You literally stand in the corner and start grabbing people. In some cultures, man, you've ruined it from that day. You just don't do that. Maybe you have to use proxies or get the most important people on your side to even ask those questions. And again, I'm not here to do that. I just want to make it clear that the things I've been talking about are very Silicon Valley culture centric, where risk is rewarded and you could go out and be direct and look people in the eye and it's okay to get thrown out or people think you're crazy, but you get, boy, in some places you do that and you've ruined it for the next whatever. Does that make sense? Yes.
Steve, as you know that we are sending 10 frontier market scouts out. They're going to be in different countries, different markets.
So excited.
They're going to be working with entrepreneurs. Some of them don't even realize they're entrepreneurs.
Right.
So collectively, I think that these scouts collect lots of raw data.
Yes.
And to you, what would be the most interesting question to ask for the collective?
Well, and stop me, I'll babble for 3 seconds. Even in other countries, right, regardless of the culture, at the end of the day, you got to figure out whether you're solving a problem that people will really need solved, or are you solving something you think they need to be solved? Again, regardless of the culture, at the end of the day, it boils down to, are you confusing your vision and passion with, like, can this thing, you might be right, but can this be adopted in your lifetime given technology or culture or whatever? And it doesn't mean that you shouldn't have that goal, but that's, to me, is the basic feedback loop of, really, well, yes, we'd like a four-lane freeway here, but they'd probably like clean water and electricity first. Or am I making sense? Or, it would be constantly iterating of what's possible within the cultural, physical, economic environment of where you're at. A lot of the little things I did get involved with overseas, particularly stuff in Tanzania, was all these wonderful, well-meaning Americans who came in and did X for Village Y, and then the problem was they did X for Village Y, and when they left, you know, no one really cared because there was no ownership. And so the other thing I'd be careful about is substituting your skill from building an infrastructure that's permanent when you leave, whether it's a profitable infrastructure, or gee, it made people's lives better and other people shared your passion. But I've now seen that continually to recognize that's a possible pattern that we get wrong when we go other places. Yes?
Can you do this research and, I don't know, this trial and error sort of field in a culture that
doesn't view the goal look like? In fact, it's probably a great discussion for the class, because I'm not an expert on those cultures. It's probably exactly what you should be talking about in some piece, either as a group or individually. That's, I think, the core of the question is, okay, I'm going to country X. Well, do you know anything about that culture? Well, yes, let me tell you about failure. Well, what kind of brainstorming things that might be applicable in this country, or what did somebody else learn in others that might actually, you might be able to use as tools? I'm truly the wrong guy to teach you that. I am the right guy to tell you, for God's sake, yeah, this is going to be a major big deal if you don't think about it before you go.
Every startup, right?
So here's I'll give you the corner cases, again described in the book. There are three types of startups. And the one where you really could get away with very little search is in an existing market, where you have something clearly better than the incumbent. And better is defined by the users, by the customers. They say better could be faster, it could be, you know, better features, it could be something. Okay? In that, the market or the customers have already told you what search is. You still have to do a little search to see if whether your definition of better actually matches theirs. But be, you know, there's not a whole bunch of invention. There's another market type, which is I'm going to take a piece of the market that already exists by cheaper. Again, the amount of search you need to do is to validate that cheaper really is the issue. It might be that, well, cheaper, I had to sacrifice some of the features. Oh, they really cared about the feature I just threw out. So there's still some search going on. Right? The next type of market where you really do have to do search is, I think I know, it's an existing market, but I really think I know what you want. It's a niche. In a niche, you're really making some assumptions about users' needs, about who the payer is, about a different configuration of product. The most search you need to do is something that hasn't ever been done before. It's a new market. Okay? And so there's kind of a hierarchy of, you know, I've just kind of concatenated a whole semester's worth of stuff in saying search really is kind of, it expands, right? Depending on how familiar, so how do you know you're in an existing market? People, there are users, there are customers, and there are competitors, right? By definition. And how do you know you're in a new market? Anybody remember what a POM was, a POM PDA? In 1995, you held up a POM, and people went, what's that? There were no users. Hold up a PDA today, and people go, oh, it's an iPhone or Android. Right? You go, oh, it's an old device. You probably never heard of it. Right, but people could tell you all about the market. Does that make sense? It's just a matter of time and adoption. Right? In 1995, you were not executing. You might have tried to execute. You would have like fallen off the rock. You had to educate. New market, it's not only search, it's education. Question?
I just wanted to piggyback off of your question. Yep. In your book, you mentioned that one of the industries in which you didn't have to do the search as much was pharmaceutical industries. But I mean, because they have a value proposition, they have a new drug that people are, if you develop a cancer drug, right, people are going to want to take this. They're going to be dying with it.
Right, so to speak.
Right.
That was a pun. That was very good.
You still have a lot of room. I mean, the point is, don't you still have a lot of room to pivot and to go back to your hypotheses with regard to your channels or how you market this, or, you know?
And the reason why I didn't want to spend a lot of time on pharmaceuticals is there's another overlay. Stop me when I'm wrong.
No, please.
Okay. It turns out all this stuff about search and execute, I've kind of cheated. It's only about businesses that have customer and market risk, right? That is, there are some businesses that for the first couple of years are just all about technology risk, which I don't think is about you frontier guys, but for just in general, what's a business that has technology risk for the first decade? Pharmaceuticals. It's a lab problem. It's a science problem. There is no channel or licensing or whatever until something works in that test tube and you go through an FDA phase one, right? All of a sudden, you're past FDA phase one. Maybe now you could hire a biz dev guy to kind of sell off your licenses or something. But it's the most extreme I use, is that the first decade is just simply, does the science work? There's no customer and market risk involved here. After that, yes, there is. Let's take another example, which is closer to what we do in Silicon Valley. A new microprocessor architecture. Gee, you'd think that's completely technology risk. And for the first year or so, it is. We have a hypothesis it'll work in the lab, and until we get some simulation results, we don't know. But guess what? It now works technically. Now what? I got to have design wins. It's just sitting in the lab. So now I have a perfect storm. I have technology, a company with technology risk and customer and market risk. Now let's go to the other extreme. Web 2.0, anything on the web. With all due respect to anybody engineering that, there is zero technical risk. You might have some at scale, you might have some in corner cases, but your risk for a web-based product is 100% customer market risk on day one. So the customer development process and this whole business model design stuff is really about focusing on reducing the customer and market risk stuff. There are other tools to work on reducing technology risk, right? We do simulation, we do, you know, computational chemistry and biochemistry, etc. Each industry has their own tools to reduce technology risk. These are kind of the first tools for customer market risk reduction. Does that help for context at all? Well, maybe it was too much, but all right. So, thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.